So I want to start with a digital action. Folks across the country pitched in to give us a theme song for this movement, for this cancel rent, cancel mortgages movement. And so I'm going to ask that the video be queued up, and I want to just have everybody enjoy some of this.
Document real life when real life's getting more like fiction each day.
Headlines, red lines blow my mind, and now this deadline, eviction or pay.
Rent!
How do you write a song when the chords are wrong, when they all sounded right in the rain?
But the notes are sour, where is the power you once had to ignite the air?
That there are like a lot of people out there who are just smiling from ear to ear at the creativity and the collective power in that statement, and what it means when people come together and say, actually, we're not going to put up with it anymore. We have each other's back and we don't have to take it. So I want to thank everybody involved in that video. Thank you so much. So before we start the call, just a couple of things. People have asked me to speak slower. I will try. Just keep reminding me. We, for media and press that are on the call, speakers will be available after the call at 1 p.m. Eastern in order to take your questions. You can also place questions in the chat box. And we are just going to get started with hearing quickly from our translator, and then we will get started with our first speaker.
Hi, everybody. We're also doing this interpreting simultaneously into Spanish, and I am putting that number on the chat right now so you can connect. Estamos ofreciendo interpretación al español también de esta sesión y la vamos a... Estoy poniendo la información ahora de la línea en español y el código de la reunión en el chat. Gracias. Thank you all.
Thank you so much to our translators. All right, let's get started. Again, you can put your questions for the speakers in the chat box. We want this to be an engaging conversation. We are gonna start with an incredible Shiro who you know, represents what the sort of concept of mutual aid is all about. The idea that when our institutions that are supposed to serve us fail us, that we come together, have each other's back, and take action, collective action together to protect ourselves and the people we love. And I've had the blessing to meet her and to watch her children play and to watch her folks eat and commune together and to see the joy that the security of a home brings to an entire community and a family. So I'm just really honored to have her. Ruby, please take us away and tell us about your incredible work in Los Angeles, California.
Thank you so much for that beautiful introduction. Hi everyone, my name is Ruby Gordillo. I'm a proud member of ACE Los Angeles. ACE is the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment and a proud member and reclaimer of Reclaiming Our Homes, Los Angeles. And my family and I have been underhoused for the last almost 6 years in the neighborhood of Pico Union in Los Angeles, paying nearly $1,000 worth of rent and all of the utilities aside. It's just not... And raising a family, it's not a desirable living condition for anybody, really. I'm 33 years old, born and raised Angelino, mother to two beautiful girls and an amazing boy. Their ages are 12 and 14 for my girls and 8 for my boy. Before finding the apartment that has been our home for the last several years, we were homeless for 6 months. My husband was living in his vehicle while my children and I shared a room at my brother's house. So I always felt very fortunate and blessed to have this roof over my head. I'll give you a description of what it's like. The building holds 20 units like mine. My unit is on the second floor. It's a studio. When you walk in immediately to the left, there's the bathroom, a small bathroom. To the right, there's a closet 3x8. My queen size bed that I share with my husband, from his side of the bed, he's arm's length from the closet. On my side, I'm arm's length from my kids' 3-decker bunk bed. From the foot of our bed, it's about a step and a half to the kitchen. It's also a very small kitchen. On opposite sides of the wall that divides the kitchen and the living space, we have commercial shelving systems. One of them on the kitchen holds my microwave, my dry and canned goods. The other one on the opposite side serves as a dresser. My bed doubles as a dining table, homework space, and as a trampoline for my son. Being that we're on the second floor, you know, we have to be cautious of not stepping too hard and get neighbors upset so that the landlord won't get involved. We have, my kids all have special needs ranging from being on the spectrum to ADHD, anxiety, depression. They're also all gifted students. And unfortunately, they're not thriving academically as they should be. And their development, both physical and mental, has been compromised by the living conditions that we've been in. So that really pressed us to take action into our own hands and reclaim this house in El Sereno. It'll be 2 weeks tomorrow that we are in this house. It's been a beautiful journey. This house was a vacant house, completely empty, and the community has made it a home for us. It's been practically completely furnished by the community. The many donations for groceries, for people coming in and doing volunteer work with my children, teaching them photography lessons and art lessons. That's been super cool. With the whole coronavirus pandemic, it was very urgent for us to take this action. My fellow neighbors in the Pico Union area all have roommates. They all go out and work. We're constantly being exposed to pretty much everyone and anything. Here we've been having the 6 feet social distancing required. My girls are in one room, my boy's in another room. I often sleep with him still because it's weird sleeping alone. Being in Pico Union, that is densely with homeless population and homeless encampments, I'm concerned. You know, they don't have access to electricity. They may not be aware of how quickly COVID is spreading, and they don't have the ability to stay clean and safe themselves, much less for anyone else. And that was one of our biggest concerns. I know that we at ACE are organizing to get the governor to really use up all these houses that are vacant on public land, whether it be owned by the city, the county, metro, LAUSD, all of these houses to be used for housing folks in this pandemic. It's really housing is healthcare right now. I'm urging the federal government to create a stimulus that really is gonna help the 99%. The 99% are not worried about bailing out corporations at this moment. We're just trying to save a life.
Thank you, Ruby.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ruby, for your story and your powerful testimony. I want folks to know that Ruby has been speaking out all over, just actually in the New Yorker. And, you know, it's through our storytelling, through the coming out of the shadows of what we think is private and making our truth, our experiences public, so that folks who are going through and struggling through the same things can know they're not alone. That's how our movements get built. So if you have a story to tell, you know, please, you can share it in the chat. You can share your contact information privately to me or others, but you could also just share your story here in the chat if Ruby has inspired you to do so. And if you do have questions for our panelists, you can also put those in the chat. Folks are monitoring that. So I want to go from one coast to the other and move east to New York. Folks, if you've been paying attention, you have both heard that New York is the epicenter of what's happening with COVID-19 right now, but it also has been the epicenter of incredible sort of sweeping progressive reforms, including around housing, landmark victories around housing. So I want to introduce Winsome from New York Communities for Change, who's going to tell us more about what's happening in New York. Winsome?
Hi.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm wonderful. Thank you for being here with us.
Okay. Fight, fight, fight. Housing is a human right. It's not just nice words that sound good. It is the profound thing that is happening for us right now. I'm right now in Brooklyn, woohoo! And we are hoping and praying that every single tenant across America will stand up, speak up. We need you to get your assembly members' number, inbox them, call them, your senators, your legislator, whoever they are, from the White House to the Poor House, we're gonna reach everybody. Tenants for too long has been walked on. See, I have this little thing across my chest, cancel rent, tax the rich, not the poor. The millionaires and billionaires of this country, it's time for them to pay up. Instead of supping everything, it's time for them to give back. So New Yorkers have been fighting, and I know other people across the state has been, and the country has been fighting. We want to bring the awareness that for too long, they are like Draculas in our soul, talking about the rich landlords, Rebney and the rest of them, and they take so much from us. The only thing left for them to do is to take the blood out of our veins. But we are not gonna let that happen. We are not gonna stand by and let them take disadvantages of us anymore. We are standing up. We are reaching out. We are shouting from the rooftop. I'm about to climb on top of my building right now and say the words, cancel rent, cancel mortgages. I'm not saying it for the big hunters. I'm saying it for the small homeowners who are suffering, because if they have a tenant or two, those tenants are out of work. I've been out of work now going 2 weeks. I may have April's rent, but I have to consider, do I give it to the landlord or do I keep it to buy food? And there are other people in the same position that I am in. We know our government can do better, from federal right down to local. They can do better, but they're showing us that they don't care. We see our governors, they're doing a good work with COVID and the mayor and whatever, but not one single word is said. Word of comfort is said towards tenants. There is still 92,000 homeless people in the city of New York. And you got to wonder, how are they doing this morning? How many of them have contracted COVID-19? How many of them will not live to see another day? We are calling, we are not begging. Don't get it twisted. We are not begging. We are demanding that government step up for tenants and help us. Thank you.
Thank you, Winsome. I'm ready to chant with you now. Thank you so much for those powerful and inspiring words. I think it's what we need to hear right now. And you're right that this, you know, I want to end with that last thing you said, which is the government can do it with us, right? Yes. The solutions are not unknown. You have them. You just told us what they are, but we need elected representatives who are partners with us and co-conspirators with us in trying to protect our communities. And we're so blessed to have two of them on the phone with us right now. I am from Wisconsin, just down the road from Chicago, where Representative Chuy Garcia is a congressman. And I remember knocking doors for his campaign. I remember the incredible work that he did at the local level. And so I just want to introduce Representative Chuy Garcia, who will tell us more about what he's doing to try to help lead Congress towards protections for tenants and folks in housing.
Thanks very much for having me.
Thank you. Representative, okay. We will come back to Representative Garcia. All right, I'm gonna move on to my sister, who is also just down the road from Milwaukee, where I grew up, but in Detroit. I think, you know, I have so many incredible stories about Representative Tlaib. I mean, from her time in state and local government to the time she spent on strike lines and being arrested with fast food workers and other low-wage workers. Perhaps one of my favorite is the very first time I got to see her in person was at a member meeting and with Detroit Action, one of our affiliates, and they were actually doing a teach-in on what the abolished prisons movement is about, what the abolitionist movement is about. And, you know, she came in and she sat in the back and she engaged in the teaching. She asked questions and she participated the entire time. And then afterwards, the director, Brandon Snyder, calls up this woman running for Congress. And she comes from the back of the room and she gets up there and she takes off her shoes and she just starts going in with us. And I never, I was like, wait, she's running for office like right now. And she sat through a 1 hour abolitionist training before she even spoke. I mean, I was floored. So without further ado, I just want to introduce, you know, the people's champion, Representative Rashida Tlaib.
No, thank you so much. I do really appreciate incredible organizing work to Ruby and others about the importance of having a home for your family and how difficult it is to even get to a point where, you know, even hearing the emotions come in, the importance of it, especially during this huge public health crisis. I think for all of us and those that are listening know this, you know, tomorrow's April 1st. It's going to become very real for so many of the people we fight for. In the issues around not only mortgages, when people talk about it, but the issue around rent, any form of access to a home, a roof over your head, is something that needs to be at the table. And there seems to be a lack of urgency, and that's where you all come in. The fact of the matter is, all the packages that come forward will always be just not far enough, and you know this, until there's a full-blown understanding that homes, housing is a human right, especially again during this public, you know, global pandemic that is happening around the country. So it is important to also know and paint, you know, put that human face to what's happening, right? You have over 3 million people already applied for unemployment benefits. These are people that lost their jobs because of this public health crisis. Again, many of them are the people we're fighting for in canceling rent and ensuring access to housing during this time. You should know these numbers are not like any numbers that this administration in the history of our country has seen ever. Even during the Great Recession, it was not as high as this so early on. And you all know the you know, I don't like to be an expert on this issue. I like to quote experts, and experts are saying in a week or so, it's going to even get worse. So we need to be able to, again, push Congress to understanding the importance of access to housing and canceling rent. I do want you to know it is so important that as we talk about these issues, that we talk about reoccurring payments. You know, this one-time payment of $1,200 is just not going to go far enough. Many of us, you know this, our neighbors already spent it. This is not going to be enough, especially because we know it's going to be weeks before people actually get access to it. Not only that, many of the people we fight for, the most vulnerable, the ones that are actually in jeopardy of being evicted out of their homes right now, are the ones that are not going to get direct deposited this money into their accounts. They're going to have to go apply through online, which is another barrier, or through filing a zero return to the federal government so they can actually get access to it. Again, all these layers of barriers to helping all Americans, and especially our most vulnerable. So I just want you guys to be centered around the fact that these one-time payments, this one-time kind of approach to this, is not what we need right now for the people we fight for. We need reoccurring payments for at least a year. We need debit cards to people. There's too many unbanked folks. There's too many people that are going to target our folks from the stores that will take 3%, $300 out of the $1,200 or whatever we decide in the future those payments will look like. There are going to be landlords, property owners that are going to take advantage of any programs that we do. So we have to be on the front lines and making sure that we protect the people, again, we fight for. So not only reoccurring payments, but also real sustainable programming around access to housing, not only canceling rent, but how can we actually ensure that people have access to homes, not only during this national pandemic, but even afterwards. I think it's critically important that you all know this. You know, what I've been hearing from my residents here on the ground is this tremendous amount of anxiety and fear. So as much as we can show them progress with our movement is critically important right now. What I mean by that is they need to know that the 100 plus people that might be listening right now, all of us are on the front lines working on their behalf. And their stories are important right now. Those stories are the ones that are going to give us credibility of why we need to talk about housing as a human right right now, especially during this national pandemic or global pandemic. So it is important that folks understand, you know, what is at jeopardy here is obviously, you know, people losing their lives, but it's the incompetence and the lack of urgency on the part of those in power of moving quickly on housing, quickly on healthcare, quickly on reoccurring payments, quickly on expansion of paid sick leave, all those things. Those are going to result in more deaths if we don't actually push them again with a sense of urgency that we need this now. This needs to be part of everything. So I really, really appreciate the invitation, Jennifer, and all of the folks around the country. Especially, I got a shout out to my organization in Detroit, Detroit Action, who have not stopped fighting to stop the water shutoffs in Detroit, have been on the front lines in fighting against injustices towards our community, our what I would call working class poor folks, those that are marginalized. Thank you so much to Detroit Action for always giving a voice to so many folks that don't feel like they're being heard or seen. But thank you all so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Representative Talib. And I'm told that Representative Garcia is now on the phone. So Representative Garcia, the floor is yours.
Good morning, Jen, Winsome, and Ruby, to my sister, Rashida from Michigan. This is Chuy Garcia. I represent the 4th District in the Chicagoland area. I want to thank the Center for Popular Democracy for convening this town hall and to thank all the tenants and advocates fighting to cancel rent and ensure everyone can stay in their homes during these unprecedented times. I represent the parts of the northwest and southwest sides of Chicago. It's a working class district with large immigrant population that has already been hit hard by business closures, layoffs, and reduced hours. Matter of fact, on my block, there's a gentleman who tested positive for the virus. He is undocumented and not working right now. His wife was laid off also because she worked at a restaurant and the restaurant closed. So this is especially hard for the undocumented, many of whom will not qualify for the individual assistance checks that many will receive. The suffering is real, and it's always communities of color, immigrants, and working class families that are hit the hardest when the economy takes a hit. So right now, all of Illinois is under a statewide shelter in place order to mitigate the spread of the virus. But tomorrow is the first of the month. Many of my neighbors, including the gentleman I just shared with you, and my constituents are worried about how they're going to pay their rent, whether they should pay their rent or hold on to the money for other needs that they will, undoubtedly experience in the coming days. They worry about whether they'll lose their jobs, their home, and how their kids will continue learning. Before enacting this last, third bill in response to this pandemic, this past Friday, I introduced a bill to prohibit eviction filings during this public health emergency. It's H.R. 6347, the Rental Eviction Moratorium Act. 2 weeks ago, I led 76 members of Congress in sending a letter to the 10 largest mortgage lenders to demand all foreclosure proceedings be halted. I'm glad to say that my bill preventing evictions and a hold on foreclosures made it into the House's stimulus bill and a more modest eviction moratorium. I should say, however, a more modest eviction moratorium made it into the Senate bill signed into law last Friday. For renters, the new law establishes a 120-day eviction moratorium for housing covered by a federally backed mortgage. This covers about 60% of outstanding mortgages and federally assisted housing. But what about the other 40%? And for how long? So it's not enough, but it's a start. And as long as everyone on this call keeps fighting in our communities, then I can keep fighting in Congress with Rashida Tlaib and other allies that we have. We know that housing is a human right. We know that evictions in our communities are a public health crisis. And we know that homelessness in the richest country in the world is a moral stain on our country's history. So please keep up the fight with me so that everyone in this country can keep their home, make their rent, and make a decent living. Thanks to everyone for joining us and for the work that you are doing. Now more than ever, we must have each other's backs.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Garcia, thank you so very much. I feel like it's such an important moment in our country's history because we have the opportunity to decide which path we go on. Do we create a system of care, a way for all of us to take care of each other, a recognition that building scaffolding around a crisis is not the way to treat our people, but instead we should actually have a system, a set of institutions that provide a social safety net in all of the moments of crisis in our life, not just the ones that greatly impact the wealthy and the powerful. And so again, I wanna reiterate that the demands of this coalition are really simple. They are to cancel rent and mortgage payments and establish an emergency housing fund, to freeze evictions, foreclosures, and utility shutoffs in all housing, not just public housing, to declare a moratorium on all work requirements for housing and to house the homeless. We know that it can be done. We're seeing it be done in other countries. We know it can be done here too. I wanna transition us now to go to hear more about how this national movement is gonna take hold and to issue, I guess, a call to action for the folks on this call. So I'm gonna go to Roberto Rodriguez from Organize Florida. Roberto, are you here?
Yes, yes.
Hi, Roberto. Thank you for being with us.
Hi, yes, I'm Roberto Rodriguez. I'm from Organize Florida. I've been involved lately, more recently, with the housing crisis that we have in the state. And now with the coronavirus, we are struggling to get, I have been without work for 3 weeks. My wife, she's a bus driver and she got laid off just when she came back from spring break. So basically our bus drivers went 2 weeks without work and then they get laid off. So they are far behind everything. So we have everything coming up, car insurance, electricity and rent. I haven't been able to work. I was doing some Uber and Social Security, but the Social Security dropped me this month. And I haven't been able to do Uber because I'm an immune suppressant patient. I'm a cancer survivor and transplanted patient. So for me, if I get the virus, it's gonna be fast and painful. And I know that, so it's terrifying to go outside. I still take medication. I haven't had an infusion. I haven't had being able to. So this is more and more coming up to all this drama, all this stress. We haven't been able to go out. We have been trying to reach out. Even unemployment, the unemployment program, she haven't been able to file her claim. And she had been doing it for a week. So we're kind of struggling right now. We need the federal government to step up and help us. This is only April. Right now our landlords, the only thing they have been doing is sending us a link to, we set up the recurring payment. So they are looking forward for May and June. And we can barely make an April. So we need to cancel rent. This is something everybody around us is going through. Everybody's scared. Everybody's just taking a day at a time, but nobody's working. Everybody's inside at home. So we need to cancel rent and we need help. Mi comunidad de español también está pasando por mucho. Son muchos los que van a quedar fuera de esa ayuda. Y necesitan la ayuda. No podemos dejarlos aparte. Y necesitamos que todos estemos cubiertos bajo esta ayuda. Esta ayuda tiene que pasar. We need to cancel rent. The Spanish community, is being left off of all this. I know a lot of people that not being able to work, and they're not having able to go out. There's nothing, not Uber, not nothing, nothing that we can do. So there's no income. We need this. We need to cancel rent. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Roberto. And I want to thank you for reminding us that even as all of us are struggling in this moment and are concerned about our families, that there are folks who are on the front lines and who are struggling even more. Our immigrant brothers and sisters, especially the undocumented community, are, you know, folks who are incarcerated and are in detention centers where, you know, the virus is spreading like wildfire, folks who are without a home and a safe place to sleep at night, who don't have access to running water. You know, there are folks who were in crisis before COVID-19 who are now in critical danger. And it's upon all of us to do the work and to fight like hell to make sure that any relief that is coming to our communities can get to those who need it most first. And that is not how this first stimulus package has gone. And it's less than what we need to truly be safe in our communities. So I promised you all that we had some action for you. And so, you know, we have a pledge that is coming up. It's about to come up on people's screen. And we're asking folks to commit to sharing a selfie or a video directly after this call to your members of Congress with the hashtag cancel rent and cancel mortgages, so that we can make our voice heard and that we can demand that, you know, people who are in power actually do what we ask them to do. So go ahead and take this quick poll if you can. It should pop up on your screen. And if you're willing to do that video post about canceling rent and canceling mortgages on your social media, please go ahead and submit your answer. Look at that. I did it too. Technology. Amazing. Okay, hopefully everybody had a chance to take the poll. I want to thank all of our speakers, all of the folks who shared their stories and our elected officials. This is going to take all of us, and it's going to take us not just contacting the folks that we think are getting it wrong, but actually contacting our members of Congress that we've partnered with before, that have been on our side before, to really demand and to ask that they put forth the types of bold solutions that our communities truly need and deserve, and that we fight like hell for all of those folks that we named that are the most marginalized, that are on the front lines, that are the most at risk. And so with that, I'm gonna just kick it over to my sister, Diane, who's gonna facilitate a question and answer session.
Yeah, so folks who have questions for any of the panelists, any of the, Representative Tlaib or Representative Garcia, they're still on the line. If folks have questions, please type them into the chat box and we'll go ahead and ask them. I'll read them out loud. And so, the first question that I can see here is for Ruby. Ruby, can you talk a little bit about what you did to prepare for the housing takeover?
We did a lot of organizing. We did a lot of organizing, a lot of community outreach. We found these vacant properties on a website that is open to the public, because these vacant houses are sitting on public land. This website is completely open. And we just decided to do random community outreach in different neighborhoods, not too far from here, actually. We door knocked and we talked to neighbors and asked them how they felt about these houses being vacant. We did outreach with the homeless folks off of Huntington Drive here in El Sereno. And we asked them if they were aware of what was going on, and if they were, how they felt about it. They said it wasn't fair. A lot of them have been living in this situation for quite some time. And they asked us if we were going to do anything about it. And I think that was the moment when it really just clicked, like, we have to do something. You know, it's the community that is asking for it, and we have to do it for them. You know, like I shared about my personal story, unfortunately, there's hundreds of thousands of stories very similar to mine. There's hundreds and thousands of stories that are a lot worse than mine. And, you know, we reached out to folks and talked to them and, you know, hey, you've been going through this hard time. Benito Flores, for example, he's 64 years old and he's been living in his van since 2005. That's as long as my oldest daughter's life. So, you know, he is a comrade in the activism for housing. So, you know, it was very easy to make that ask, you know, like, are you willing to do something as big as this? And, you know, he said, yes, I said, yes, we reached out to other folks and they were up for it. So we just took it in our hands to do it. You're on mute.
Thank you, Ruby. We have another question here. And this one I want to throw out to the representatives that we have on the line. What is, you know, how quickly can we get rent cancellation happening at a federal level? We have plenty of folks here who are struggling. They haven't been able to get a hold of even companies to help them move. And so folks are interested to see how, you know, from you all, like, what do you think we need to do to make sure that these demands get heard at a federal level quickly? So this one's for Representative Tlaib or Garcia.
So I don't know if Chewy's still on, but I know Congressman Chewy Garcia and I both sit on Financial Services Committee, which has been leading the fight in regards to creating pathways for economic stability, including housing justice. And I know that Chairwoman Waters is extremely supportive of measures like this and understands the sense of urgency and has been really pushing leadership and others. I think there is a much bigger appetite, or I think momentum in the House side. It's just trying to get the Senate to agree with a much more aggressive approach to canceling rent and providing access and to housing and economic opportunities that are more sustainable. So I can't give you a timeline because, you know, one, I don't want you to get, I got upset, but you know, after they passed the last relief package, the Senate basically went to recess for a month. That does not mean they can't come back. Does not mean we haven't stopped. We have already started talking about the fourth package, relief package, disaster package. I don't like calling it a stimulus. I think it should be called a relief package for the American people, for our neighbors, no matter their status. And so I to give you a better timeline, I just know now people are starting to work on the next relief package. So this is when we all need to start advocating and not waiting until, you know, final text gets sent out. And what we saw is all the stuff that we worked on so extremely hard in the House, a lot of that got taken out when it got to the Senate. So we need to really work hard now on the Senate. I know, again, Financial Services Committee, Chewy Garcia and I, all of us have been, I've been working on the boost, what's called the ABC Act. And it's a boost to communities act. Chewy Garcia has been working on canceling rent. I know some of my other colleagues have been working really hard on, you know, local communities grants, expanding CDBG, expanding funding for homeless communities and our neighbors. So I know all of us have gotten a lot of approval from the House side that they would like to see this part of the package. We just have to work on the Senate. That's my personal experience in the last few weeks dealing with this crisis. But I think Chewy might have more to say.
Thank you. I think Chewy is no longer here. I think that's all we have time for in terms of questions. But if folks have other questions that they want to share, or even just their own personal stories, please continue to share in the chat box, and we will do our best to get back to all of your questions, even though we don't have time to talk on the call.
Thank you so much, Diane, and thanks everyone for your questions. Folks are taking great notes. I think we just want to end this call with two quick things. One is to say wholeheartedly with all of our spirit and everything we have inside of us that you and your family and your community deserve more, that you deserve a life of dignity, that you deserve a life full of joy, that you deserve to be protected in moments of crisis, but you deserve to live a life without every moment being a crisis. And so, you know, as we move forward in this fight together, as we, you know, fight for, as Representative Tlaib said, for relief, for aid, you know, certainly not what our families need or deserve, we want to remember that we have to fight this frontline fight, and, you know, which means canceling rent, which means canceling mortgages. And then we have to continue our fight to build a world and a community and a country where all of us have the freedom to thrive, where all of us have the things that we need to live a life full of dignity. So thank you again for everybody who participated on the call. Remember, please make your video, use your social media today to advocate for canceling rent, for canceling mortgages. You know, the first is tomorrow. People need to see that folks support them if they're going to take this bold action, and if they're going to fight this fight with us. And with that, we will say goodbye so folks can get on social media and start posting. Reach out to your community, reach out to your families, reach out to your neighbors, tell your loved ones you love them, and be safe out there, everyone. For members of the press, we will facilitate a press call with the panelists in just like 2 minutes here.